Earlier Skeptic Squids, Dr. John Baumgardner is said to be the expert when it comes to flood geophysics. Whatever that means. He's even cited by Andrew Snelling, saying he's done some really good research in the 1980s using computer models to simulate runaway flood events, runaway geophysics. I don't know what he's talking about, so let's just give him a chance to actually explain.
I believe a major crisis took place in the late 1700s. Christians in Europe, knowledgeable of the geological record, simply could not conceive at that point in time how the Genesis flood could possibly have produced so much geological change in such a brief event as the flood.
Probably because what they saw in the field changed their beliefs, and instead of manipulating the data to fit the Bible, they came to the logical conclusion that, hey, maybe the flood did not make as much sense as we thought.
And their failure to defend Genesis 6 through 8 as the explanation for the fossil-bearing sediment record opened the door to naturalism on a grand scale.
Naturalism is the belief that only natural forces act in this universe, as opposed to supernatural forces, and that the origin of any structure in this universe can be explained by studying natural processes. Naturalism can be traced back as far as the 12th century, where just ordinary Catholic scholars would go around looking at natural processes and try to explain them, instead of just going, eh, God did it. Naturalism actually peaked in the 16th and 17th century, when more and more Catholics began to study the world around them and take notice of what's going on around them. A good example would actually be Galileo Galilei. In my opinion, I think Christians realize that you can use really simple concepts to explain really complex things, and they sort of start to migrate God to the sidelines, saying he wouldn't actually directly influence everything, but he would rather put things into motion at an initial starting point. You know, saying Christians failed to prove the flood makes no sense. They were just not as intellectually dishonest as you are.
The technology developed to detect submarines during World War II provided a crucial piece of the puzzle, previously unknown. And during the 1950s, maps of the seafloor began to become available. And it was breathtaking. The results were breathtaking. Discoveries, things that people never even suspected, suddenly appeared on the scene.
You're wrong. Alfred Wegener predicted the existence of a mid-Atlantic ridge in 1912, along with his hypothesis that the continents fit really well together at the continental shelves, and at some point in the past they must have been connected. Unfortunately, his hypothesis was not taken seriously by most geologists, simply because he didn't give a really good mechanism which would cause continental drift. Some people did take what he says to heart, including Alexander de Toit, the famous South African geologist.
In particular, what is known as the mid-ocean ridge system became known for the very first time. And notice this highly symmetrical mid-Atlantic ridge. This ridge is part of a chain of high topography, some 40,000 miles long, running like a baseball seam through all the world's ocean basins. So immediately, Earth scientists began to puzzle as to what could possibly be the explanation for this feature, this major feature of the Earth's surface.
The discovery of the mid-ocean ridge system really brought back Alfred's idea of continental drift, along with the idea that, hey, maybe the seafloor is actually spreading. In the 1960s, plate tectonics was born, with the evidence Alfred put forward of fossils stitching the continents together, and now an actual mechanism to drive the seafloor spreading, plate tectonics was released into the wild, and it is still going strong today.
And one of the most immediate issues was the age of this feature, the age of the rocks that are exposed on the ocean floor, especially the igneous rocks, but also the sediments.
No, that is not the first problem. Upon discovering, the people went, wait, what the hell is that? What the hell formed it? And only then did they ask, when did it form?
And an astonishing discovery was made, namely the young age of today's seafloor. All of today's igneous seafloor basement rock has been formed since the first appearance of dinosaur fossils in the strata record on the continents.
This is not surprising, since seafloor is constantly being subducted back into the mantle. The oldest seafloor is about 180 million years old, with the first dinosaurs being found in the Triassic period about 230 million years ago. So you're not exactly wrong.
In other words, the world's ocean floors are younger than a large fraction of the sedimentary record on the continents. So what are some of the methods that were employed to come to this conclusion? One way of getting a relative age of rock in the ocean relative to the continents were fossil correlations between ocean bottom sediments and continental shelf sediments.
Notice I was using the word relative age dating. Using this word to accept some geological evidence, but then just disregard the rest. Relative age dating, it's actually kind of simple. When you're studying a geological cross-section, as a geologist, there are a few things that usually spring to mind. And that is, how did the layer form, and when did it form? So, here we have a little geological cross-section I made up. So, to use relative age dating, we first have to understand the law of superpositioning. That is, any layer found at the bottom usually means it's been deposited first, and layers found at the top usually means they've been deposited last. Any sort of effects or any sort of features you see extra could change up the story a little bit. Here we have a fault and two unconformities. So a fault means that somewhere along the line the layers have been shifted by a tectonic event, and unconformity simply means that it has been a very long time since the last layer was deposited. Anything could have happened in that event. Faulting, falling, and just tilting of beds even could have happened in that event. So we first have to break down this entire bed from top to bottom. On the very top, we have some layer of volcanics marked in red. The layer of volcanics has to have been deposited way after this entire bed formed. There's a fault line, but the fault stops at the unconformity. It doesn't go through. Also, the entire bed has been tilted as well, which further increases the length of time that have passed. Second, we have an unconformity event with the fault running through it. This means that this layers here were deposited, then the position stopped, the beds have been tilted, another layer has been deposited on top of that, and then eventually a fault happened. This means that this fault is older than this deposition event right here. Lastly, when we look at this, we can see that there's a conformity running through these beds here. Now sure, the fault runs through them, but that simply means the fault is much younger than these two beds here. But since these three beds here have been eroded away and then these other layers are deposited, we can then layer the dates as follows. First, we have the youngest being the volcanics. Then a fault occurred. Then we have a layer of rocks that were deposited, which then eventually formed some conglomerate using the superposition principle. That's the third oldest, the third youngest. And then we have a layer of sand was deposited and eventually divided into sandstone. That's the fourth youngest. Then there was a really large time between the position of these three layers and eventual deposition of that layers. So then we can layer this one here, the fifth, the sixth, and the seventh, using the superposition principle. We now know that these three layers here are very, very, very much younger, or older, rather, than this volcanic deposition here. If we really want to put a number to the age of these rocks here, we'll have to go find somewhere where we can apply radiometric dating. One dating method that comes to mind is argon-potassium and argon-argon rating. This works really well for sedimentary rocks. Let's say, for instance, somewhere out there, close to this, but not too close to be confused of these rocks here, we have a similar event where we only have these three rocks here. In the rocks there's fossils, but not only fossils, there's enough of the radiometric material so we can actually put the quantitative date to these rocks. Once we have the dating of these rocks, we can then analyze the fossils in those rocks to get a really good idea of what fossils occurred at when and what time. So we can then go and we could draw up a little taxonomic graph like this, where A, B, and C is a particular species, and the line represents, in millions of years, how old or when these were found in the fossil record. If we draw a line through here now, in blue, saying that we are lucky enough to find a radiometric dating of the rocks right here, between the existence of A, B, and C. This means in the rocks where we found this, let's say we give it a nice age of, I don't know, maybe 200 million years. We now have a date we can put to the existence of the coexistence of these three species. But eventually we can see that in some of the older rocks, we don't have species B because it hasn't evolved yet. C has been evolved quite a bit long time in the past, along with A, and is still going strong with B. But A eventually died not a few million years after this chronological date here. Now we know at what pattern to look at, and we can analyze these rocks here, and even these rocks here, to get not only a relative, but a pretty good number on how old these rocks have been. So if we go and look at this alluvium here, and we find that, well, we can only find A and C in them, we know they're younger than 200 million years. If we then go and we go to the very top part of the alluvium, we realize, wait, there's also A, B, and C. This puts it in a really nice bracket of concurrent taxonomy where we can say 200 million years is a good age for this rock. Of course, we don't have any more information to really pinpoint every single layer. But obviously, if we can find certain elements in this layer, we can then get a really good estimate on the actual date. Of course, volcanics would be necessarily easy. It's very important to note, however, that not a lot of metamorphoses have occurred here. If there were some serious metamorphosis here, let's say contact metamorphosis, as in an igneous body rise through and burned the living hell out of these rocks here, you'll have maybe a nice forming, it's probably not enough energy for a schist, but you could have the quartz turning into a quartzite. Some of the fossils might actually survive this metamorphosis process, but the isotopes or any sort of radiometric dating would now sort of reset their clock. And if you date rocks, you'll only know when the metamorphosis occurred, not necessarily the deposition event. If we now go back to the other rocks, if there's no metamorphosis that occurred there, we can use those dates there along with this pattern to date these rocks right here. Quite simple, right?
In addition, there was a magnetic reversal pattern that was discovered. And this pattern occurs in lavas, volcanic lavas on the continents. It occurs as magnetic minerals settle out of solution and appear in these sediment cores. Their alignments, their magnetic alignments can be measured. And one sees a magnetic reversal pattern in the sediment cores, and also in the basaltic basement rocks of the ocean floor, these magnetic directions are recorded.
Yes, studying paleomagnetism can give us a relative age of an igneous or sedimentary rock, but it's not very useful on its own. It's usually coupled with radiometric dating or fossil dating. You don't even explain to us how this dating method works. Suppose we have a fresh igneous rock. Any magnetic material inside of this rock would be free to orient itself to Earth's magnetic field. Cooling this rock down through its core temperature would cause the magnetic particles to freeze in place, so that any magnetic field change after it's been cooled down enough would not affect the poles inside this rock. Since new seafloor is constantly being formed, any change in the magnetic field of Earth would record itself in the magnetic rocks. Now this is sort of similar to how a vinyl record works, where the change in the depth of the grooves will cause a change in sound. That's why you hear a sound. But now comes the difficult part. How exactly do you make sense of all these bands? Change in the Earth's magnetic field does not occur in regular intervals, so we can't count the bands like we can count rings in a tree. However, the entire Earth's magnetic field actually changes, so all the rocks will have the same pattern at the same time. Because these patterns are so irregular, we can sort of use them like a fingerprint. Given enough sample points, we can eventually construct a table correlating all the data, and you can use bands to identify other rocks of the same age. Again, coupling there with different geological dating methods, we can create an accurate relative dating method for these rocks.
And these correlations also indicate that the ocean floor is young relative to the continental sediments.
Sure, because the old oceanic rock is being subducted and recycled back into the mantle. It's also not a rule though, because we can actually find sediment on Earth that's quite a bit younger than 118 million years.
And finally, there were rocks dredged from the ocean floor, and the radioisotope values could, from this basaltic basement rock, could be compared with continental basalts.
Now how sneaky is that, just brushing off radiometric as being relative? It's not relative, it's an absolute dating method.
It confirmed this young age for the ocean. So this discovery that the ocean floor was young precipitated a paradigm shift in the Earth sciences in the 1960s, a major paradigm shift.
Yes, there was a major paradigm shift, but that's because it was made clear that plate tectonics is a thing.
So how does this discovery affect our understanding of the flood?
No, it does not affect the flood, because the flood is a fairy tale, and real life evidence does not affect fairy tales.
Well, it implies that all of today's seafloor has been formed since roughly the midway point of the Genesis flood cataclysm.
He's been giving lackluster explanations so far, and Yuri's just going completely mad. He hasn't even given a time estimate of when this event occurred. No explanation even.
If the flood is responsible for the fossils in the sediments on the continents.
But it's not, because there's no proof for it.
And the seafloor is younger than a good fraction of those sediments. It means that all this seafloor has come into existence, has been formed since that sometime in the middle of the flood.
What you're doing here is assuming the flood occurred as it is stated in the Bible, and then grasping at every little bit of evidence that might seem that it could prove your flood to be true. However, the actual evidence you present tell a whole different story.
It's the logic is just that tight and strong.
It really isn't though. Why then in real life, if we observe the oceanic crust, we have parts that are only a few thousand years old and parts that are 180 million years ago, if it was formed in just one quick event?
Well,
why don't we have one thick homogeneous layer of sediment across the entirety of Earth?
And again, it
I knew it.
And so this implies that thousands of miles of continental motion had to have occurred during the flood.
Yet, we don't see any evidence for this.
It implies that none of the pre-flood ocean floor remains at the Earth's surface today.
This is also not true, because the remnants of the Typhus Ocean can be found in the Himalayas because of a massive continental collision between India and Eurasia.
In other words, all the ocean floor that existed before the flood is missing from the Earth's surface.
No, it's not missing. We can still find remnants of ancient oceanic crust. Also, I really like the fact that you're just reading everything off the screen.
Many Christians haven't really thought much about the mechanism of the flood. Many of them, about the last teaching they had on this subject was when they were 4 years old in Sunday school, and they learned the song about the rains coming down and the floods coming up.
I think it's because most creationists understood it as being a fairy tale and are not as intellectually dishonest such as yourself. This video is getting way too long, and I'm gonna cut it short right here. The next video will come quite soon, and then we'll dive into more complex geophysics models of what's going on inside of the Earth, which would finally destroy John Baumgardner's idea of cataclysmic plate tectonics. I'm going to use this opportunity to say very, very, very much thank you to Pologia. Or Pologia. Keep confusing those two. Thank you very much, dude, for allowing me to on your channel. And a very special thanks to everyone who's from his channel. I really hope you guys subscribe because you think the content is okay and you're looking forward for future content. As you can see, I reply to most, if not all, of the comments. And I read all the comments. This is a fact, I do read all the comments. So yeah, if you feel like adding anything to the videos, do a comment thing down below. If you really like the video, do the annoying thing where you have to click to make the like thing. I mean, it's annoying. Yeah, but it helps a lot because it does all statistical things, blah, blah, yay, yay. And if you really feel like my content is good enough and you feel like it requires a monetary donation, Patreon is there. It's not necessary, but it's there. Again, thank you so much for watching and stay tuned for the next video. Enjoy the rest of your day.